हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम बैक। माई सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर करंट अफेयर्स। सो टुडे यू हैव 1st of May 2021। एज यू नो दैट दीज लेक्चर्स आर बेसिकली बेस्ड ऑन द करंट अफेयर्स, राइट? यू मस्ट स्टडी फॉर दैट पर्पज द नेशनल न्यूज पेपर्स लाइक द हिंदू और इंडियन एक्सप्रेस। अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट यू कैन ऑल्सो रेफर सम ऑफ द करंट अफेयर्स, right? The booklets which are available from the leading coaching institutes, right? And you can also, you know, supplement your preparation with the help of these lectures. These lectures are basically uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis, right? And you can subscribe the channel on the YouTube, that is Future IAS, for your daily current affairs. Fine. So let's begin with the class. Okay. So first news is related to Soli Sorabji. The Soli Sorabji was basically an Indian jurist, right? He was an advocate and he was born basically in 1930 and he was recently died due to the coronavirus, you know, complications. So he died basically on 30th of April 2021 due to the COVID-19, you know, related disease or related pandemic. Okay. So he was basically an Indian jurist. So he was an advocate. And he was designed as a senior advocate of the Bombay High Court in 1971. And he was also served as the Solicitor General of India, right, from 1977 to 1980, right? And he was also served as the Attorney General of India from 1989 to 1990, that is the first term, and again from 1998 to 2004 for the second term, okay? All of you would be probably knowing about the words, the term called Solicitor General of India and Attorney General of India. See, Solicitor General of India is basically, you know, is a subordinate to the Attorney General of India. That means the Attorney General of India, which is the higher authority than the Solicitor General of India, first of all. So, what is this Attorney General of India and Solicitor General of India? So, first of all, the Attorney General of India is called the first law officer of the country. And the Solicitor General of India is called the second law officer of the country, because Solicitor General of India is considered as a basically, you know, subordinate. Okay, or it is assisted by the Solicitor General of India. Now, when you say it is the second law officer of the country, that means it is also assisted by the additional Solicitor General of India. And the current Solicitor General of India is basically Mr. Tushar Mehta. And the Attorney General of India is basically the highest law officer of the country, and the main purpose of Attorney General of India and the Solicitor General of India is to represent the government of India whenever it is called so in the High Courts or in the Supreme Court, right? And whenever it is required by the government of India to be present, right, in such the court of the record where the government of India is basically a party. Okay. Regarding its the contribution in 2002. The Soli Sorabji also received the Padam Vibhushan, right, for its work regarding to its defense of the freedom of expression and the protection of the human rights, right? He was also working with the Citizen Justice Committee, right, which he represented in 1984 during the anti-6 roid victim case, right? And he was also appeared in the most prominent cases like Keshwanand Bharti case versus state of Kerala, the Menaka Gandhi case versus Union of India, SR Bommai case versus Union of India, and IR Kolio case versus state of Tamil Nadu. So you have probably the knowledge about the Keshwanand Bharti judgment. The Keshwanand Bharti judgment, the Supreme Court basically propounded the doctrine of basic structure. Okay, so doctrine of basic structure is basically propounded by the Supreme Court during the Keshwanand Bharti judgment. In the Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India, the case basically is a landmark ruling which basically stand as a bulwark of the right of personal liberty which is been granted under Article 21 of the Constitution. Okay, the third basically is SR Bommai versus Union of India. This is basically a landmark judgment of the Supreme Court where the Supreme Court basically discussed in very length and breadth of the provision of Article 356, that is the removal of the basically governor, right? So he basically for the purpose of basically, you know, your president rule, right? For the purpose right? The Article 356 is basically in depth. It is discussed by the Supreme Court of India, and it is also related to Article 356, and it has basically the huge impact on the center-state relations. So you have three types of emergencies. The first is Article 352, that is national emergency. Okay, Article 356, that is also called the state's emergency, or it is also called the precedent rule, right? So the Bhumai case is basically is very useful for the removal of, you know, basically your, you know, the elected government, and hence the imposition of the precedent rule in the state. And in the IR Polio case versus state of Tamil Nadu, it is very important case with respect to the basically your ninth schedule. The ninth schedule is basically a schedule in the Constitution of India, which provides that certain law have certain immunity from being judicially reviewed. So this nine judge bench of the Supreme Court basically have gave this verdict regarding, you know, the upholding of the Keshavanand Bharathi judgment, which was basically delivered in 1973. So it upheld in the IR Polio case the Keshavanand Bharathi judgment, and it says that the the right to have, you know, basically the to check the legality of any law is basically a basic structure doctrine, right? And no law can take away this right from the Supreme Court of India. That means the right to have the judicial review, right, of any legislation, whether it has been put under ninth schedule or it has put under somewhere else in the Constitution, right? It should be judicially reviewed, and it should be open to the judicial review. So in the IR Polio case versus state of Tamil Nadu, the Supreme Court very categorically says that whatever the law which have been placed in the ninth schedule after Keshavanand Bharathi judgment or after Keshavanand Bharathi verdict, right, they are open for the judicial scrutiny or for the judicial review. That means in the IR Polio case, the Supreme Court basically upheld, right, the right to have the judicial review, right, which is the most important fundamental, which is the most important basic structure of the Constitution, right? And the Soli Sorabji also appeared in the most important case called BP Singhal versus Union of India, in which the Supreme Court very clearly held that the state governors could not be dismissed without the due case, right? So certain other parameters related to removal of the state governors are also discussed in this BP Singhal versus Union of India. Okay, so he was basically the Soli Sorabji who was recently died because of coronavirus. Okay, next, the drone delivery of COVID-19 vaccines. Now you know that because of coronavirus, right, all of your basically the supply chains are basically disturbed because of, you know, the lockdowns, and because of imposition of Section 144, and because of all sort of restrictions, curfew like restrictions which are imposed on a certain places. Now it is also not feasible for the persons to go and deliver certain, you know, vaccines or certain items, right? So for the purpose of delivering of the vaccines, right, that are the COVID-19 vaccines, right, the Telangana government basically took the permission for the drone use. The drones now will be using, right, for the experimental delivery of COVID-19 vaccines, specifically to the Telangana. So Telangana government has taken the permission. So here the Ministry of Civil Aviation and the Director General of Civil Aviation both have granted the conditional exemption for the drone deployment to the government of Telangana. Now government of Telangana would be basically using the drones for experimental delivery of COVID-19 vaccines. Now here the drones would basically, you know, granted the permission for conducting, right, the delivery of COVID-19 vaccines. Now regarding Directorate General of Civil Aviation, as you know that it is a basically statutory body means it has been set up under the law which have been passed by the parliament, right? The Directorate or Directorate General of Civil Aviation basically investigates the aviation incidents and maintain all regulations related to the aviation, and it is also responsible for issuance of the license pertaining to the aviation. Okay, now this permission which is being granted to the Telangana government for the use of the drone specifically for the experimental purpose of the delivery of COVID-19 vaccine, right, it is being a one-time exemption which is being provided for 1 year only. So that means this exemption is valid for 1 year or until further order which have been given by the Directorate General of Civil Aviation. Okay, Similar type of exemption is also being provided by the Directorate General of Civil Aviation to the Indian Council of Medical Research, right, for conducting the feasibility study of the vaccine delivery during the drones, right? So the ICMR also have using the drones for conducting the feasibility study of transporting or sending of this COVID-19 vaccine by using drones. And this study is basically conducted with a collaboration with IIT Kanpur. As you know about Indian Council of Medical Research, Indian Council of Medical Research is basically located in New Delhi. It is an apex body in India for formulation, for coordination, and for promotion of biomedical research. You can say that Indian Council of Medical Research is one of the oldest medical research bodies in the world. It is one of the oldest medical research bodies. How? Because it was started in 1911, way back, right? So it was started 1911 by the government of India as the Indian Research Fund Association, right? It has the specific objective of sponsoring and coordinating the medical research in the country at that point of the time in 1911, okay? And after independence, when the country got independence, several important changes were basically made in the organization. And now, the organization which was previously known as Indian Research Fund Association, now it has been redesigned as the Indian Council of Medical Research in 1949. Okay, and its scope and other, you know, its mandate have been expanded significantly, right? And it has been funded by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, Government of India. Okay, so here you can see the drone basically which will be used for delivery of COVID-19 vaccines. Okay, next, May Day, it is also known as International Labor Day. Okay, so every year on May 1st, the International Labor Day is being celebrated throughout the world. Okay, and now you must understand the International Labor Day or International Workers' Day is often known as the May Day. Okay, now what is the purpose why we celebrate the International Workers' Day? We celebrate the International Workers' Day, right, to honor the contribution which was made by the workers, which was made by the laborers, right, specifically the men and the women, right, in the development of the world, in the development of economic, you know, economic and the social development, and to pay the tribute to the workers which have made their sacrifice in achievements of the economic and the social rights all over the world, right? So it is basically an honoring to the contribution which have been made by the workers, specifically in the socio-economic development of a particular country. Okay, so here the day of observance basically every year on the 1st May is basically celebrated as World Labor Day or International Workers Day or International Labor Day. Okay, and the day was basically chosen because at that day, the 1st May basically at the first day, what happens is the Pan National Organization of the Socialist and the Communist Political Parties, right, which basically, you know, commemorate the Haymarket affair, which was basically occurred in the Chicago on 4th of May 1986. So what is that Haymarket affair? See, Haymarket affair is basically a Haymarket incident. It is nothing but a market which is located basically in the Chicago or in the Chicago Square. So in the Chicago, which is a basically, you know, a city in the USA. So what happens is there was a riot or there was an incident, right, on the May 4th, 1986, when what happens is when the labor protest rally was there, right, it was near this Haymarket Square. And this, all of a sudden, this protest rally, which was basically, you know, conducted by the laborers, right, it suddenly, you know, got violent. And there was a riots. And what happens is they somehow threw a bomb at the police. And what happens is in the retaliation, at least 8 people died, right, as a result of violence. And this day, which was basically organized as a protest rally, right, on May 4th, 1986, right, it was to commemorate the sacrifices which were made by the laborers specifically for the development of socio-economic, aspect of the country. This International Day of Observance related to the International Workers' Day or International Labor Day is basically celebrated. And in India, the first Labor Day or the May Day was celebrated in 1923 in Chennai. And subsequently, this was being held every year since 1923 onward. Okay, So here you have the Happy May Day, which is also known as the International Workers Day or International Labor Day. Okay. Next, Operation Samudra Setu II. Okay, so as of you know, first of all, let us understand what is Operation Samudra Setu. So Operation Samudra Setu first. So that is just name, that is first or second. Okay, so let us understand first Operation Samudra Setu. Then we'll go to what is first, what is second. Operation Samudra Setu, which was launched on the 5th May 2020, last year, right, as a part of the national effort to repatriate Indian citizens from the overseas. As you know that, because of COVID-19 pandemic, the Indian citizens or the Indian origin citizens, basically they have stuck in the foreign countries, right? To repatriate the Indian citizens from the overseas, the Operation Samudra Setu was started during COVID-19 pandemic. It was started on May 5th, 2020, right? And it was basically, you know, led to the successful, you know, repatriation of around 4,000 Indian citizens, right, back to their homeland, to India. Now, this was Operation Samudra Setu first. The Operation Samudra Setu second was basically again launched by the Indian Navy, right? And it is basically launched in the aspect of augmenting of several, you know, the medical oxygen requirement in the country. So here in the Operation Samudra Setu second, the Indian Navy will basically, you know, go and you know, take some of the basically ships or naval warships, right, to fill them with the medical oxygen and to come back with those medical oxygen to India, because nowadays the medical oxygen supply is basically very low, right? So to fill those shortfall related to the medical oxygen, right, this Operation Samudra Setu second was basically implemented, right, in order to augment the medical oxygen supply in India. Okay, so this mission, which was deployed Indian naval warships, this will take the shipment of liquid oxygen, right, which will be filled in the cryogenic containers, and that would be providing, you know, much relief to the COVID-19 patients. So here the two ships, first is INS Kolkata and the second is INS Talwar. They have entered into the port of Manama in Bahrain, right, for basically transporting around 40 million tons of, or 40 metric tons of the liquid oxygen to the Mumbai. The similar INS Jalshava is basically going to the Bangkok, and INS Erabat is going to the Singapore for bringing, you know, the liquid oxygen to the, basically to the India. So these operations are basically conducted for the purpose of bringing the medical oxygen or the liquid oxygen to India in order to fulfill the shortfall in the, basically in the oxygen supply to the COVID-19 related patients. All right. So as you know that in India, there is a shortage of the medical oxygen. In order to augment, in order to fulfill that shortage, right, this operation, Operation Samudra Setu, right, second was basically implemented. I already told you Operation Samudra Setu first, where you have, you know, as a part of Vande Bharat mission, right, repatriated around 4,000 Indian nationals that were basically stranded, right, due to the COVID-19 pandemic. And the Operation Samudra Setu first have successfully repatriated around 4,000 Indian nationals that were stranded in Maldives, Sri Lanka and the Iran. Right, it was successfully brought back. Okay, fine. Next, the sustainable livelihoods for tribal households in India. Okay, so this is basically a scheme, right, or it is simply a project which was launched, or which was launched for the purpose of bringing livelihood opportunities for the tribal people. Right, now the TRIFED, which is basically a primarily, you know, the tribal agency, now have entered a project called the Sustainable Livelihood for the Tribal Households in India with the Link Fund, right? The Link Fund is basically philanthropic operational foundation, right? The main purpose of implementation of this Sustainable Livelihood for the Tribal Household project, right, basically is to eradicate the poverty specifically in the tribal households by providing them a sustainable livelihood opportunities, right, and definitely to mitigate the effects of climate change. And it is also something which is mandated to the Link Fund Foundation also. So here the TRIFED and the Link Fund both have entered a MOU on April 29th, 2021 for the purpose of providing the tribal development and the employment opportunities, the livelihood opportunities, right, and to provide a much needed support for increasing, right, the value of their products, right, which is also related to the tribal product. Regarding the agency called TriFed, TriFed was basically, you know, was established in 1987. Okay, what is the TriFed? TriFed is basically a multi-state cooperative society act 1984, which was basically set up this TriFed as a national level cooperative body. TriFed comes under the administrative control of Ministry of Tribal Welfare, Government of India. The main purpose of the TriFed is to bring about the socio-economic development of the tribals, right? Definitely within the country by institutionalizing, you know, the trade of the minor forest produce, right, which were basically brought by the tribal people, as well as to trade certain related to the surplus agricultural produce, which were collected by the tribals in the tribal land, right? Regarding the link fund basically is located or is situated in Geneva, Switzerland. It is basically a philanthropic operational foundation. Okay, it is working towards eradication of poverty and also mitigating the effects of climate change. Okay, now as I told you that as a part of association, both of the organizations, TriFed and the Link Fund, both will work towards creation of the women-centered infrastructure and innovation and entrepreneurship, so that the tribals will have the livelihood opportunities. They will have all sort of developmental avenues, right, so that they can gain the sustainable employment facilities, right, as well as it will also tackle the extreme poverty eradication which is there among the tribals, right, as well as it will also empower them in terms of, you know, their own produce, in terms of the minor forest produce, which they will be able to sell with the help of this type of initiative. Okay, next, the Satyajit Ray. As you know that the Satyajit Ray is basically a noted or legendary filmmaker, right? The Ministry of Information and the Broadcasting basically has decided to organize a long year centenary celebrations, right, basically across the country and the abroad, right, in the homage to the legendary filmmaker Satyajit Ray. So Satyajit Ray was basically born on 2nd May 1921 and he died on 23rd April 1992. Okay, Satyajit Ray was basically an Indian filmmaker. He was also the screenwriter and he was also artist, lyricist, author, and widely regarded as one of the greatest filmmakers of all the times in the Indian history. Okay, so Satyajit Ray basically directed 36 films, right? Some of the most popular films and documentaries, right? And the shorts which were also performed, which were also directed by Satyajit Ray. The most important films like The Pather Panchali in 1955, right, along with Aparajita Rao, right, and Apur Sansar in 1959, right, as well as the Apu trilogy, which was also directed by Satyajit Ray. And he has also authored several short stories and the novels, right, specifically the working on the children's and the teenagers. And he was also instrumental in bringing certain fictional characteristics like the Feluda, Salute, Professor Shonku, right, in which he also contributed in the greatest sense. Okay, the Satyajit Ray basically received the major awards in his career. For example, he has received 32 Indian National Film Awards as well as an Academy Honorary Award in 1992, right? As you know about these film awards, so first of all, the government of India honored him as a Bharat Ratna, which is also the highest civilian award in 1992, right? Regarding the Indian National Film Award, the Indian National Film Awards is basically presented every year by the Directorate of Film Festivals, right? It is an organization which is set up by the Ministry of Information and the Broadcasting, Government of India, right, to facilitate the best of Indian cinema. Okay, regarding Bharat Ratna is basically the highest civilian award, everything you know about it. Okay, next, the scheme for the special assistance to the states for capital expenditure for the year of 2021-22. Now, as the name is very clear, that the scheme for special assistance to the states for capital expenditure, that means This is a scheme for providing the special assistance or a special financial assistance to the states, definitely by the center, for the purpose of capital expenditure, right? For capital expenditure for the year of 2020-21-22. Now, the most important point here is that certain financial incentive or financial assistance will be provided to the states only for capital expenditure. What is capital expenditure? You can say that a capital expenditure is basically for the capital project. The capital project is basically, you know, such a project which is where the cost of the project is basically capitalized. That means the most common example you can understood of the capital projects are basically, you can say, the infrastructure projects like the railways, roads, dams, right? As well as you have certain other projects like subways, pipelines, refineries, power plants, lands, buildings. They are all considered as a, you know, your capital expenditure. Now, Department of Expenditure has issued a fresh guidelines, right, with regard to the scheme of financial assistance to the state for capital expenditure for the year of 2021-22. Now, this project or this scheme was already underway in 2020-21. Now, the Department of Expenditure has or Government of India has decided to continue this scheme for the, this year also because of there is a high demand for the states. Now, so under this scheme, a financial assistance is basically provided to the states, right, in the form of 50-year interest-free loan, right? So there, the states has to repay that loan, simply loan, without an interest in the 50-year timeline, okay? And here, the amount of loan which is fixed at around 12,000 crore rupees. Now, for the purpose of the financial year 2020-21, right? And a sum of 11,830 crore rupees have already been released to the state in year of 2020-21, okay? So the main purpose is to basically to sustain the state level capital expenditure specifically for the capital projects. Just now I have explained you the capital projects like infrastructure projects like dams, roads, railways, right? In addition to your pipelines, refineries, power plants, land, buildings, etc. are considered as a capital projects. Because now the states are facing very severe shortage of the finance because of the pandemic. Right, because of all sort of economic activities are basically standstill, right? So in order to provide the positive response or in order to provide the financial incentive to the states and also the positive response which is received from the states, right, the government has decided to continue with the scheme for the year of 2021-22 also. Okay, next, the legal meteorology packing rules 2011. So first of all, as you know that because of coronavirus or COVID-19, there is a huge shortage of the oxygen in the country. Now, there is also a huge shortage for those the medical devices which are also related to the providing the oxygen support to the COVID-19 patients. Now, in order to speeden the import of these medical devices which are basically useful of providing this oxygen support to the COVID-19 patients, those medical devices will now be allowed to import, right, without prior mandatory declaration of for the next 3 months. That means you don't have to prior declare for the import of those medical devices, right, as stated by the Ministry of Consumer Affairs in its notification. So you must understand the basic law for such declaration of the medical devices which were imported from the other countries. The basic law is basically the legal meteorology packaged commodity rules 2011, which makes it mandatory to get approval prior to the import. But now they can be imported, but now here is that they must be, you know, they must get, you know, the custom clearance, right? So importers just have to make all necessary declaration after custom clearance, but definitely they should declare, right, or the importer should declare definitely well before these medical items before sold to the consumers, right? So before selling to the consumers, the importers has to make the necessary declaration regarding these medical devices. Definitely after the custom clearance have been given to such import of the medical items. Here, the Department of Consumer Affairs, Government of India basically administered the Legal Meteorology Act, right? This act basically provides an application of the legal requirement for the measurement of, you know, for the measuring instruments also, and the objective of this act is to ensure that a public guarantee from the points of view of security as well as the accuracy of, you know, certain measurements which will be done based on that. Okay, and there are the rules which are also made, the legal meteorology packaged commodity rules 2011, which was the main purpose of bringing of these rules is to have the consumers to have the informed choices about these pre-packed commodities, right? So there the informed choices will be provided to the consumers based on these rules that were made in 2011. Okay, next, the Yudhvir Singh. The Yudhvir Singh was basically a freedom fighter. He was also a politician as well as he was also a doctor. He was basically a homeopathic doctor. So the Vice President of India have presented the Yadavir Memorial Award, right? This award was granted, or this award was presented to Hyderabad based gynecologist Dr. Evita Fernandez, right? Dr. Evita Fernandez basically granted Yudhvir Memorial Award, right, for the cause of the women's healthcare and the empowerment, as she is basically a gynecologist who was basically, you know, awarded for their contribution related to the women healthcare and the empowerment. Now, Vice President of India has also paid a tribute to the basically a freedom fighter known as the Yudhvir Singh. The Yudhvir Singh basically was born in 1897. He died in 1983. He was basically an Indian freedom fighter. He was a politician and he was also a homeopathic doctor. And the Yudhvir Singh was also associated with the Arya Samaj. So he was basically a member of the Arya Samaj. And he also edited the publication of the Arya Kumar also, right? So regarding Arya Samaj, as you know that Arya Samaj is basically the monotheistic Hindu reform movement that basically promotes the value of, you know, which is basically based in the infallibility authority of Veda, or simple infallibility authority of Veda. The Samaj was basically founded by, as you know that, Maharishi Dayanand Saraswati in 1875, and the members of the Arya Samaj basically reject the idolatry pratha or idolatry system. Okay, he was also a leader of Indian National Congress, and he was also took the participation in the pro-independence struggle of 1932-1941 as well as in the Quit India movement in 1942, right? And also he was become the secretary of the Delhi Pradesh Congress Committee, and he was also the municipal commissioner of Delhi in 1937, and he held the post of municipal commissioner of Delhi also until 1952. So he had the various portfolios, right? And he held also the membership of Indian National Congress, right? As well as he was also involved in the freedom struggle, right? That will become the part of the freedom struggle in 1932-41 and Quit India movement in 1942 also. Then he later served as the Minister Health and the Rehabilitation, Industries, Labor and the Rationing and the Jail in Delhi State Government between 1955 and 1956. So he held the various portfolios basically as a Minister of Health, Rehabilitation, Minister of Industries and the Labor, as well as the Rationing and the Jail, right? And during his tenure, the Delhi Homeopathic Act was basically passed, right, in 1956. The Singh was later awarded the Padam Shri in 1971, and he was also awarded a Padam Bhushan in 1977 by the Government of India. So as you know that Padam Shri is basically the fourth highest civilian award in the Republic of India after Bharat Ratna. Bharat Ratna is basically the highest, you know, highest award which has been awarded by the Government of India. So in terms of ranking, the first is basically the Bharat Ratna. Okay, then you have basically Padam Vibhushan. Okay, then you have Padam Bhushan, and then you have the Padma Shri. Then you have Padma Shri. These are the basically the fourth highest award which have been granted, right, by the Government of India every year on the India's Republic Day celebrations. All right. So he is basically the Yudhvir Singh. Okay. Then the standards for the spices. So here the Codex Committee on the Spices and the Culinary Herbs basically have finalizes the quality standards for the four spices. That is for the cloves, for oregano, for basil, and for ginger. So for these four spices, our quality standards have been finalized by the Codex Committee on Spices and the Culinary Herbs. Right? It has been finalized during its fifth session, which was held virtually on 20th to 29th of April 2021. Now, this committee, which is also known as the Codex Committee on the Spices and Culinary Herbs, forwarded these four standards to the Codex Alimentarius Commission for the adoption of the final step, that is a full-fledged codex standard for the purpose of these four species, like or spices. So first of all, let us understand what is the Codex Committee on the Spices and the Culinary Herb and what is this Codex Alimentarius Commission. So first of all, let us understand a brief background about it. So to develop and expand worldwide the standards for the spices and the culinary herbs, right, as well as to consult some of the international organizations in the standard, right, in the process, the Codex Committee on the Spices and the Culinary Herbs was basically formed in 2013. Okay, it was set up, right, with the support of more than 100 countries with India as a host country at that point of the time. And the Spice Board of India basically act as a secretary for organizing the sessions of this committee, which is known as the Codex Committee on the Spices and the Culinary How, right? So since its inceptions, right, related to, you know, the Codex Committee on the Spices and the Culinary Herbs have been successful in developing, you know, the harmonized global codex standard for the spices and the herbs. Now, regarding the Codex Alimentarius Commission, the Codex Alimentarius Commission was basically set up in 1963, right? It is basically an intergovernmental body which is established jointly by the United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization as well as the World Health Organization. So what is the Codex Alimentarius Commission? It is simply an intergovernmental body which is set up by the FAO, which is basically United Nations Specialized Agency or Food and Agriculture Organization, as well as the World Health Organization, within the framework of Joint Food Standard Program to protect the health of the consumers and to ensure the fair practices, right, in the food of trade. All right. So this is all about the basics of your CCHCH as well as your CAC. Okay. Now, the committee basically also took up the following new work items, basically to develop the codex standard for the small cardamom, as well as to develop the codex standard for the turmeric, as well as to develop the standard for the spices that falls under the dried fruits and the berries, right? And the codex committee, or simple you can say that, the Codex Committee on the Spices and the Culinary Herb, or that is CCSCH, is a basically youngest of the Codex Commodity Committees, and it is being chaired by India, as well as the Spice Board of India is its secretary that I have just now explained to you. Okay, the committee is mandated to elaborate the worldwide and the science-based quality standard specifically for the spices as well as for the culinary herbs. That is definitely in accordance with the Codex principles of consumer protection as well as the fair trade practices. And current chairman of this Codex Committee is basically Dr. M.R. Sudarshan. All right. So that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs. Thank you very much.